Thanks for tuning in to Mirror Now this morning. You're watching the News This Hour with me, Rishi Kapoor, here are the top headlines we're getting to you at this hour. After 9 years, D-Day for Talwars in Allahabad High Court today to pronounce verdict on plea of Talwars seeking guilty in the horrific double murder of Arushi Talwar and Hemraj. 23 people were killed, but our politicians are not responsible. Probe report on Mumbai stampede blames the rains. Rumours for the mishap gives government an absolute clean chit. The Rail Ministry sets up another panel to probe the delay in construction of a new footover bridge in Mumbai's crowded Elphinstone station. Not decisive action, but yet another committee seems to be government's solution to this problem. Sex with a minor, even a wife, is rape, rules the Supreme Court in a landmark judgment. No protection given under the marriage law for child rapists. Mirror Now exclusive, Maharashtra Environment Minister Ramdas Kadam first supports the Supreme Court's ban on crackers and then later backtracks. He says there will be no cracker ban in Maharashtra. Karnataka Chief Minister defers action on the city's potholes till after rain. This even while deadly potholes caused accidents that claimed 5 lives in just 10 days across the state. Veteran actor Anupam Kher appointed as the new chairman of the Film and Television Institute. Kher succeeds Gajendra Chauhan for the top post. And a top focus of the dates, D-Day for the Talwars at the Allahabad. The court is all set to deliver its verdict on an appeal filed in the infamous Arushi Talwar murder case by her parents Rajesh and Nupur Talwar that challenge a CBI court order convicting them of the murder, Arushi and the domestic help Hemraj in 2008. The couple were awarded life sentence by a special CBI court back in 2013, and the dentist couple are at present serving their sentence in Ghaziabad's Dasna jail. 14-year-old Arushi was found dead inside her room in Talwar's residence in Noida with her throat slit in May 2008, and the suspicion was initially on the servant, the 45-year-old Hemraj, the domestic help who had in fact gone missing. But after his body was recovered from the terrace of the house 2 days later, the suspicion shifted to the Talwars themselves. And today it's going to be judgment day for the Talwars there. The Allahabad High Court is all set to hear that plea that has been filed by the Talwars on their conviction of murdering their own daughter. Remember, this is a 9-year-long case that has gone through many upheavals. Initially, of course, the Noida police there was accused of botching up the entire investigation, following which the government had in fact handed over the case to the CBI. Several teams of the CBI too were in fact changed during the course of the investigation, and following which in November 2013 the Talwars in fact were convicted of murdering their own daughter. And 4 years later today, the Allahabad High Court is going to hear the plea that's been filed by the Talwars challenging that conviction. But the question here is, will the Talwars walk free? Remember, so far the grounds on which in fact they have been convicted is all circumstantial evidence. There's only been circumstantial evidence, indirect evidence, on the basis of which they in fact have been convicted. They are going to be presenting all of that in front of the court. In fact, the hearings concluded back in January, and today is the day that the Allahabad High Court is going to pronounce their verdict. We understand the verdict is going to come any time after 1 p.m. today, but this is going to be a top focus through the day here. Remember, this murder case had sent shockwaves across the country because this mystery continued to deepen, because there were several theories that did the rounds. Priyank Tripathi joining us now live. Priyank, back in 2008, when this case came to light, this had sent shockwaves across the country. In fact, you very closely have been tracking this case, the trajectory of this case. Take us through the sort of upheaval this case had witnessed and the sort of theories that had come to light.
Certainly, this case has seen so many twists and turns, and many investigating agency also probe it. First of all, the case was probed by the Noida police officers the moment they got a call around 6:30 on 6 in the morning by Rajesh Talwar. The police officers from Noida reached to the spot, and but the crime scene was not at all so much protected. There was an access which was given to outsiders also, which has caused the maximum damage to the case. Later on 17th, Rajesh Talwar was informed by the Noida police that another body was found on the rooftop, because Rajesh in his FIR mentioned that his domestic help Hemraj has killed Arushi, and after that he has fled away from the spot. Arushi's body was found on the bed. Hemraj's body was on was found on the rooftop. Looking at the sensitivity of the case, later on the UP police transferred this case to a special crime unit, which was SIT, which started probing the case. And suddenly Rajesh Talwar was arrested, because he was a key eyewitness, key person whom the Noida police suspected. First team of CBI was given the responsibility to probe this case. CBI also had several findings like statement of the domestic help, as well as Bharti, the key eyewitness, who was the first one to reach at 6:30 in the morning when she spotted that Arushi's body was found on the bed, when Nupur came out running out of the house, and she informed Bharti that Arushi's body was found on the bed. One more team of CBI later on joined the investigation, which led to a conclusion that a closer report should be filed in the case. Henceforth, the CBI team, which was the second team, which was headed by late AGL Call, who was the ace investigator of the Central Bureau of Investigation, found that there is a need to file a closer report, but the circumstantial evidences were such strong that it was indicating, the CBI mentioned, that in our approach, Talwars are the one who have killed Arushi, because the theory of two dead and two alive, that means the two bodies were found from the house of four people who were living. So these are the two left people who were alive would have killed Arushi and Hemraj. That was the theory which was given by the Central Bureau of Investigation. But during the course of argument which happened in the trial court, there were several arguments which were in the favor of Talwar, and some arguments were in the favor of the Central Bureau of Investigation prosecutor, because the domestic help Bharti mentioned it before the court that she was told to say something like this. The domestic help, the three accused who were arrested by the Central Bureau of Investigation, who were also taken to the narco analysis test, gave a clear indication that Talwar was the one who had killed Arushi. Later to that, on the conclusion, the trial court of special CBI court in Ghaziabad came to a conclusion that Talwars were the murderers. Hence, they were given life imprisonment. After this verdict came out from the lower court in Ghaziabad, a petition was moved from the Talwar side before the division bench in Honorable High Court of Allahabad, which will pronounce its order today, that whether the order which was passed by the trial court, which was the special CBI court, will stand, or the Honorable Court will come to a conclusion that Arushi's parents, Talwar's husband and wife, will be released by the Honorable High Court. So it's a very important day, since 4 years and 16 days Talwars are inside Dasna jail, from where they are closely keeping a close tab on whatever developments are happening in the court. According to the counsels from both the side, they have told it to us that there are 15 points on which the argument was focusing, and these 15 points included the testimony of the key eyewitnesses, the forensic examination report, because several examination report had come with several different conclusions. That was the main point which made this case so complex, that there was a very difficult position for the Honorable Judge of the Trial Court also to come to a conclusion. The evidences were circumstantial, but the indication that the testimonies of several people and the point of CBI that the two dead and two alive theory was a final factor, and the statement of the Bharti was a final factor, because of which the Honorable Trial Court pronounced the order against the Talwars. Today is the day when everyone is waiting to know that the decision of the trial court will stand, or it will be the Talwar will be released by the High Court. What we are expecting that around 1:30, the order is going to come out at the Allahabad High Court in the UP today. Back to you.
Absolutely, Priyanka. Allahabad High Court all set to seal the fate of Talwars. But would it be safe to say here, Priyanka, that the Talwars do have a strong case at the court? Because so far what we've understood is that the conviction was based and built around only circumstantial evidence. There was no direct evidence. Their conviction was based on indirect evidence. So far there were no fingerprints that were in fact found off them. And there was, in fact, for the longest time, the murder weapon also was not found. So if we speak about the case that has been presented in front of the High Court, do they have a strong case at hand?
See, there's no denial about the fact that the CBI mentioned it before the court that there was tampering of evidence, because Talwars were the one who were inside the room, and Talwars were awake till late night. Rajesh Talwar in fact switched on and switched off the router, which was told by the CBI, because the router modem was fluctuated for the few minutes, which gave an indication that someone was awake till 12:30, and in the morning when Nupur Talwar told to the domestic help Bharti that Hemraj has killed Arushi, that was the key factor which had gone against the Talwars. Many evidences were not in place. The toys of Arushi's room were totally clean. There was no blood sample which was found. There was no blood stain on the wall of the room. These were the evidences which were presented before the court, which clearly indicated that the evidences were tampered. When Hemraj's body was also found, Rajesh Talwar first said, he also mentioned in the FIR that Hemraj is the one who has killed Arushi. Later on he changed his statement when the body was found. So that was the point on which the CBI in this proceeded, and there were many forensic examiners like the one who Sunil Dode, who conducted autopsy on Arushi's body, also received a call that a sexual assault should not be mentioned in the FIR in the autopsy report. I'm sorry. So these were the things which were giving indication that something was being hidden by Talwars. Later on the Talwars side, they focus on the different statement, the changing of statement of several key eyewitnesses, the statement which were made by the CBI officials, the changing of statement of Bharti, and in fact Bharti also told it to the court that she was told to say something like this. That's why she gave a statement against Talwars. So these were important 15 pointers on which argument happened in the trial court, and similar thing was repeated before the Honorable High Court in Allahabad. Today the court will decide, the Honorable Court will decide that on these arguments whether Talwar should be given should be released, or the order of the trial court will stand still after the court will expect will be giving the order at 1:30 today.
So what are we expecting at the court today? There could be a possibility of them being acquitted. The second possibility that we're looking at, that there could be a possible retrial that can be ordered.
It's very difficult to, inappropriate in fact to make any assumption on the court's order, because it's totally on the court that what court will decide. The arguments we can tell to our viewers, but we won't be in a position to tell that what can be the exact order of the court. Certainly there are weak points which has gone in the CBI side, and there are as well weak points with the Arushi's parents side. The big question is that whether Arushi will finally get justice or not. We know that Arushi's parents were convicted and they were given life imprisonment by the trial court, which was a special CBI court. But the big question is that the decision of the trial court, which was contested before the Honorable High Court, will come to a different conclusion or not. Because till now, we know that the lower court had come to a conclusion that Talwars were the one who killed Arushi and Hemraj, and later on they tried to destroy the evidence. Now after the series of argument, because the both defense and the prosecution are very, very much assured that yes, they will be getting a favorable judgment, but now the court will decide that what will be the further course of future of Arushi's parents, whether the decision by the trial court was true or not, whether the decision of the trial court, which was contested by the Arushi's parents, by the accused in this case, will stand true or not. These are the factors on which the court will give its order. We are expecting that the order will come at 1:30 today.
All right, Priyanka, do stay with us. Let's quickly recap of what's really expected today. The Allahabad High Court is all set to seal the fate of the Talwars. This is a 9-year-old case that in fact has seen a lot of upheaval, lots of ups and downs. Remember, the Noida police was criticized for a botched up investigation soon after that. The CBI took over the case. Several teams of the CBI too, in fact, were changed. Their statements kept changing. And after several years now, the case is now at the Allahabad High Court, as the Talwars have now appealed, have filed a plea stating that the conviction is absolutely wrong. In fact, they've challenged their conviction there. Priyank is getting us all the latest. Priyank, if we speak about the trajectory of this case, we saw over the past few years how there were several theories that did the rounds. That take us through some of those theories, you know, that were put forth.
Certainly, we'll have to go into the detail of what happened and how what was the sequence of incident. On 16th morning, Rajesh Talwar was the one who first called the Noida police official, and he informed that Arushi's body had been found in the room. On 17th, at 10 o'clock, there was another call which was made to the Noida police, informing them that the body of Himraj or someone has been found on the rooftop, which was hidden by the panels of the cooler. When police officials reached, they found decomposed body on the terrace, and later on when Rajesh Talwar came back from Haridwar, he found out that it was Himraj's body. The Ballantine bottle which was found on the table of their dining room had 5 fingerprints which was not matching with any of the Talwars. That was a thing which clearly suggested that someone came from outside and he tried to consume that alcohol. Their pillow cover which was found in the room also did not match the sample of Himraj. That means Himraj, physical presence in the room was also contested, which was a theory which was given by the Central Bureau of Investigation. That was the argument from the defense side. Later to that, key eyewitnesses like Bharti, the domestic help who reached first to the flat, was the one who told to the CBI officials that Talwar was the one who told her that Himraj has killed Arushi. That was a theory which was also contested, because Bharti told it to the court that I was told by the officers to say something like this, which was totally ignored by the trial court. That point was once again contested by the defense side. Another round of example was switching and switching off of the router. If the router was switched on and switched off in the night, someone would have done that. That was the point which was told by the CBI officials. So there were several things, several theories: arresting of the servants, arresting of Talwar, later on Talwar being and CBI officials filing a closer report in the case. These were the things which the points which made the case so complex that everyone started speculating that what could have happened inside that room of L32, which is in sector 25 of Jalvayu Vihar. The trial court came up with the order on 26th of September, exactly 4 years, 16 days back at the Ghaziabad High Court, where the court said that according to the court, after listening to the arguments and knowing about the statement and the forensic examination of right. All the sides, I have come to a conclusion that Arushi's parents, Nupur Talwar and Rajesh Talwar, are the one who had killed Arushi and Himraj. Today is the day when the petition which was moved by all right. Arushi's parents, who are also accused in this case, who are the prime accused, who have been given a life sentence by the court, had contested before the High Court, and now the court will decide that what will be the future of this biggest murder mystery of India.
Absolutely, it is the biggest murder mystery. In fact, 9 long years, in fact, we've been tracking this case through the day, that this is going to be a top focus. Priyank Tripathi, we'll keep coming back to you as and when the day progresses. Remember, 1:30 p.m. is what we are looking at when the Allahabad High Court can in fact pronounce its verdict in this case. Joining me now, Mr. Amit Khemka, also Sujay Kantawala, both of them being eminent lawyers. Mr. Khemka, thanks for joining us this morning here at Mirror. Now, this case, of course, has been absolutely shocking in the terms of the way it's developed, because there were several theories that did the rounds, and eventually it boiled down to the fact that the parents killed their own daughter. They were convicted. They have in fact been serving their sentence at Dasna Jail since the past 4 years. They appealed at the High Court, and that plea, in fact, the verdict of that plea is going to be pronounced today at the Allahabad High Court. What are we expecting today? Take us through what do you think can be expected at the court today?
So far as I am concerned, you know, in 34 years of my practice, I have, this is one of those judgments by the special courts which has absolutely no legs. In fact, he admits at several places that there is no evidence against the Talwars of having committed this gruesome crime. However, he, you know, in 200 odd pages, he just keeps on presuming and assuming the things, and thereafter he says that there are circumstances which lead him to believe that it was the Talwars who committed the crime. So far as I am concerned, I would be very, very surprised if the High Court upholds this conviction. In fact, you know, there are so many stories, there are so many contradictions in what the judge says himself. And he does not give any benefit of anything, any doubt or any circumstance to the Talwars. It is, in fact, in the first three paragraphs of his judgment, the judge has actually convicted them, and thereafter he goes on in 200 pages to try and support what he said in the first three paragraphs. So this is not the way the judgments have to be written. In fact, he should have first gone through the evidence and then come to the conclusion. It is not that he should have come to the conclusion in the first three paragraphs and then, you know, he tries to use very, very flowery language in the judgment as if he was writing some kind of a thesis. You know, to me, the judgment of the special court was very, very shocking. There is absolutely no evidence to give this kind of conclusion. There is absolutely no evidence, in fact, you know. And so far as Talwars are concerned, they went for the narco test. Both of them opted for the narco test, and the special court just brushes it aside when the thing is found in the narco test. He says it is not a circumstance which favors them. I mean, you tell me, if a person is guilty, would he not be afraid of going for a narco test? Even the people who are not guilty are afraid of going for narco test, because it can come out with any kind of funny thing. So if they went, they had so much of faith in themselves probably, or in their innocence, that they opted for it. And police could not find anything out of that. They could not find even any lead. So, I have to give this one circumstance is enough to give them the benefit of doubt. And
all right.
I don't know why the judge thought like that.
All right, Mr. Khemka, do stay with us. Mr. Sujoy Kantawala, your response to that. Do you believe that the CBI based this case entirely on circumstantial evidence? Because we do know there was no direct evidence, and this conviction completely is based on indirect evidence. Keeping all of that in mind, do you think that the Talwars have a strong case today?
Well, it's a 216-page order which was under scrutiny by the division bench of the Allahabad High Court. The jurisprudence in this country that has developed is that everyone is presumed innocent till proven guilty, and procedure established by law and the rules of evidence have to be followed. Now, this was a case primarily based on circumstantial evidence. And you know that in criminal jurisprudence, knowledge, intention and purpose, there has to be a motive, and the chain of circumstance has to be complete to prove conspiracy, because conspiracy was also one of the charges apart from 302. Now, in this judgment, he has largely relied on circumstantial evidence, and he has relied on two particular provisions of the Evidence Act which are critical, that is 106 and 114. For the benefit of the viewers, 106 is the facts which are solely within the knowledge of the person, are to be kind of presumed. And secondly, the court can presume the existence of certain facts. So if a person solely has certain facts within his knowledge, he has to mention those facts because only he knew about those facts. Now, if he doesn't say, then they are to be presumed. And court can definitely take into account all primary and secondary evidence or material to presume the existence of certain facts. This is basically the largely the lower court, the special court, Justice Lal, has based this 216 page order and he has convicted the parents for the murders. Now the High Court very interestingly will have to, perhaps the High Court is not debarred from reappreciating the evidence and completely thrashing out the order or upholding it. So it will be very interesting to see, and for students of criminal law, we are always students during life, it will be very interesting to see as to how and on what basis the High Court deals with this. So I would wait for the High Court to pronounce its verdict.
Absolutely, Mr. Kandavala, stay with us. So essentially the High Court would have to decide broadly on two questions, whether the prosecution version of events establish all the facts that it relies on, and secondly, is there any direct evidence that establishes that someone else killed Arushi other than the parents, Mr. Khemka?
In every case, so the court therefore the evidence act therefore allowed has the that liberty and that freedom to presume the existence of certain facts. So let's see what the High Court does. Let's see what the High Court does.
Right, Mr. Khemka, your response.
So I think so the High Court actually will in this case, in fact the High Court will have to reappreciate the evidence, because to my mind it is not the question of saying yes or no to what the special judge has done, because High Court will have to actually reappreciate the evidence. And that is why if you see the history of this case, the matter was reserved once in January 2017 for judgment, and thereafter High Court again, when it found certain contradictions in the evidence, so High Court again ordered for a rehearing in the matter. So it is of course that the High Court is going to reappreciate the evidence, and I hope that if there is an evidence against them, I am not privy to the nitty-gritties of the evidence, I am not privy to the statements in this case, I have to base solely on whatever I am saying on the basis on the judgment of the special court. So if there is something against them, let them be convicted, no doubt about it. But to my mind, in the judgment of the special court, I do not find that evidence which is beyond any doubt and which proves that these two people have committed this offense. There are so many presumptions, there are so many ifs,
Absolutely.
There are so many buts in this case, and therefore they were entitled to benefit of doubt.
All right, Mr. Khemka and Sujay Kandavala, do stay with us. We're slipping into a very quick break. Our continuous coverage on D-Day for Talwars continues on the other side of this very short break. Welcome back. All eyes at the Allahabad High Court today as it's expected to deliver its verdict on an appeal filed in the infamous Arushi Talwar murder case by her parents, Rajesh and Nupur Talwar, that challenged a CBI court order convicting them of the murder. That said that Arushi and their domestic help in 2008 were murdered by the Talwars. The couple was awarded life sentence by a special CBI court in 2013. And the dentist couple are at present serving their sentence in Ghaziabad's Tasna jail. 14-year-old Arushi was found dead inside her room in the Talwars Noida residence with a throat slit back in May 2008. Suspicion was initially on the domestic help of the 45-year-old Hemraj, who had gone missing. But after his body was recovered from the terrace of the house 2 days later, the suspicion had shifted to the Talwars there. But today all eyes there at the Allahabad High Court because they are going to be in fact pronouncing their verdict on plea that has been filed by the Talwars challenging their conviction that says that they murdered their own daughter. Remember, this is a 9-year-long case which has gone a lot of upheavals. There have been several theories that did the round, and eventually in 2013 a special CBI court convicted the Talwars themselves for murdering their own daughter. We have more reactions coming in on the story. Let's listen into some of them.
The main event in this case is the murder. Where does this murder take place? Does this murder take place in Arushi's room? Or does it take place elsewhere? For the moment, the CBI has not been able to, despite several questions by the judges, been able to provide any clue or any evidence to suggest that Arushi and Hemraj were murdered in the same room at the same time. That is the basic premise of the case. The motive of the case, or the one that's been ascribed to the Talwars by the CBI, rests on the fact that the parents discovered the servant and their teenage daughter together in her bedroom at an inappropriate time, and that is what led to the sequence of events. But for the moment, they have not been able to establish Hemraj's presence in Arushi's room.
26 नवंबर 2013 इस दिन डॉक्टर तलवार दंपति को सीबीआई कोर्ट ने उम्र कैद की सजा सुनाई थी. उसी के खिलाफ इन्होंने इलाहाबाद हाई कोर्ट में अपील की थी. उसी अपील पर सुनवाई हुई. इस बार जो सबसे खास बात है इस बार की सुनवाई में, इसमें दोनों जज ने कोर्ट नंबर 40 के, इन्होंने एक एक पॉइंट को बहुत ही इत्मीनान से सुना, एक एक बात पर बहस की. और सबसे खास पॉइंट जो सीबीआई ने कहा था कि दोनों कत्ल एक ही कमरे में हुए थे, आरुषि के कमरे में, इस पर बचाव पक्ष ने जो दलील दी पूरे साइंटिफिक एविडेंस के साथ, उसमें ये बताया कि जब आरुषि के कमरे में जब हेमराज अगर था तो उसके कमरे में हेमराज का भी ब्लड होना चाहिए था, जबकि साइंटिफिक प्रूफ में कहीं भी हेमराज का ब्लड आरुषि के कमरे में कहीं भी नहीं मिला. तो इस पर जब बहस हुई तो उसमें इस तरह के भी सवाल उठाए गए कि जब अगर दोनों का ब्लड होना चाहिए था, अगर ब्लड वहां पे नहीं मिलता है तो क्या आरुषि के माँ बाप ने सिर्फ हेमराज के ब्लड की सफाई कर दी?
अनफॉर्चुनेट घटना हुई है, उसके अंदर जो तथ्य सामने आए हैं वो कभी नहीं हो सकते अगर उसमें माता पिता का रोल ना हो. उसमें आप अपने सिस्टम से रिलीफ ले लो या उसको उल्ट कर दो और बात है. वो मैं जो आपका जुडिशरी का सिस्टम उसमें नहीं जाना चाहता हूं, उसके कोई कमेंट नहीं करूंगा, बट एज इन्वेस्टिगेटर I really find them guilty of doing it.
Mr. Sujoy Kantawala still with us. Mr. Kantawala, help us understand if there's any precedent that can be referred to, because in this case repeatedly what we are hearing is that there's not enough evidence to convict the Talwars. There's only circumstantial evidence that has been put out on the basis of which the Talwars were convicted. In a case like this, legally, do you think the judgment was correct? And if there is any precedence in terms of criminal cases that can be quoted here?
See, the case is completely factual based because the trial court has got has presumed 26, has culled out 26 instances on the basis of which the trial court presumes that the parents were guilty. They are largely circumstantial in nature. The pillow, the golf club and all these kind of things. Now, CBI is not an astrologer. CBI is not all-knowing, all-pervasive to find out everything. So, in these kind of peculiar cases where certain events have to be presumed, the lower court, in all due respect to the lower court has put in effort, 216 pages of this judgment, which is likely to be upset or
right,
kind of concurred with by the High Court by today afternoon. It has largely gone on the circumstantial evidence. See, look, listen, which parents normally, the charge is that the parents killed the daughter. Have you ever come across normal people even presuming even to hurt their children. This is murder in the most gruesome way. So therefore, one should not go into morality and public opinion, because huge public opinion was divided on this issue. Court goes on the basis of evidence. And therefore, as I said earlier, where all the pieces of a puzzle cannot be pieced together and made into a complete chain. It may happen in such cases. Suppose a body is found in a field or a body is found floating in the well. You have no eyewitnesses. What do you do? So therefore, at that time, the court can presume the existence of certain facts. But then there is always, it is subject to appeal, because this is the life and death situation of a particular person. And here in this case, it is not stranger. It is the parents who are alleged to have murdered their own daughter. Some say, some one theory was that in a fit of passion, they saw her in some kind of compromising position with that guy. So therefore, Rajesh Talwar took this in a fit of rage. Now all these facts, then the narco test, and then, so therefore ultimately all this will now be under scrutiny of the highest division bench in the state. And of course, one cannot be disillusioned, because then ultimately there is the Supreme Court also. But the High Court can completely overturn this verdict, can sift the evidence, can go through each and line and demolish and thrash the order, or can also uphold it. So here you have only one way of looking at it, yes or no. So it will be very interesting to see as to how and on what basis the High Court deals with this. And it is definitely going to be a tretse and a history lesson. In a sense, it's going to be a textbook for us to read as law students, to see as to how the High Court deals with it.
Absolutely. But Mr. Kantawala, when the verdict came out, the Council of Talwars has stated that the entire case is riddled with numerous infirmities and that the evidence was not properly appreciated, and also further mentioning there that they had hoped for a hard-hitting judgment by the court, even with regards to the botched up investigation that the Noida police had in fact carried on.
See, what happens sometimes, we lawyers, when we handle a matter very passionately, we get a little involved also. So I would not go and step into the shoes of the defense or the CBI, the prosecutor, because each one has done their job to the best of their ability. So let's give credit to them. I would not like to speculate on any comments made by any of the sides. The judgment of the special court was out. The judgment is under scrutiny by the High Court and has already been scrutinized. So we are awaiting the view of the division bench. I think we should await, and then there will be a lot of discussion after that.
So broadly, do you think the High Court has to in fact look at two broad questions? Firstly, could the prosecution version of events establish all the facts that it relies on? And secondly, that is there any evidence that establishes that someone else killed Arushi other than her parents? Broadly, this is what the High Court has to decide on today.
In its appellate jurisdiction, in its appellate jurisdiction for a 302 appeal, that is murder.
Right.
When you are dealing with the life of two people, the lives ultimately, because naturally they could be staring at capital punishment or less, life imprisonment, whatever. So the High Court definitely will be empowered, and it is empowered under the law to completely scrutinize both the sides. They will scrutinize both the views, and ultimately they will decide whether the lower court's view convicting the parents was correct. The High Court can do anything. The High Court has got supervening powers in its supervisory as well as appellate jurisdiction to thrash it or uphold it. It depends on the pleasure of the High Court. But we have seen that the High Courts, when they deal with such cases of very sensitive nature where the lives of citizens are involved and it's a matter of a gruesome murder, the High Court really takes its own time. The High Court applies its mind, and that's why hats off to the judiciary, because they have to completely go through all the arguments. They have to go through each and every line of the lower court order. So it's real and arduous task which the Honorable Division Bench has undertaken. And therefore, these pearls of wisdom which will fall at around in the afternoon will be very interesting to read.
Absolutely. Mr. Kantawala, appreciate you joining us here this morning at Mirror. Now, as you're mentioning, this judgment will serve as a useful precedent in trying crimes committed behind closed doors or the four walls of a house there. We are going to look at that verdict today that is expected at around 1:30 p.m. this afternoon. Appreciate you joining us here. And let's now move next to Miranau's special campaign, Make Our Locals Safe, for the inquiry report on the stampede at Mumbai's Elphinstone Station.